Hi, I am Dr. Goodmanson with a rapid derivation video intended for the readers of my book, General Aviation Aircraft Design, Applied Methods and Procedures. In this video, I will show how the familiar equations used to calculate the forces of lift and drag are derived. Sometimes I'm asked, how are the lift and drag equations derived? This refers to the familiar expressions lift equals 1/2 rho v squared SCL and drag equals 1/2 rho v squared SCD. The answer is provided in this video. In short, this is accomplished using dimensional analysis. The term dimensional analysis refers to a method that establishes relationships between parameters that describe some natural phenomenon. A well-known and very useful tool inside dimensional analysis is Buckingham's Pi-theorem. The fluid dynamic forces acting on a moving object are derived using this theorem. Due to time constraints, I am not going to cover it in detail. Interested viewers can find this in most textbooks on fluid dynamics. However, I am going to show how it is used to derive the equations of lift and drag. In physics, parameters like mass, length, time and temperature are called base quantities, so-called because they have a single unit like a kilogram, a meter, a second, and degrees Kelvin. These are called primary dimensions. To make the approach more generalized, we represent the base quantities using specific symbols. Thus, mass has a primary dimension often denoted using capital M. The length is denoted using capital L. Time using capital T, and so on. The base quantities give rise to derived quantities. For instance, a force is defined using the familiar expression F equals ma, where m is mass and a is acceleration. Thus, the mass can be represented using the primary dimension m, whereas the derived quantity acceleration, which is in terms of length divided by time squared, is represented by L divided by T squared. Therefore, we can write the force using the primary dimensions as shown. In contrast, the derived quantity area, A, is represented by L squared. Therefore, the derived quantity pressure, which is force per area, can be written as shown. M times L divided by T squared divided by L squared. This can be shortened further, as shown here. Let's use Buckingham's Pi theorem to derive an expression for a general aerodynamic force, R, acting on an object moving through air. This force depends on the density of air, rho, represented by the primary dimensions m divided by L cubed. The denser the air, the larger the force at any given speed. This means it is also dependent on the object's speed, v, represented by the primary dimensions L divided by T. The faster the speed, the larger the force. It also depends on the size of the object, call it L, represented by the primary dimension capital L. The larger the object, the larger the force. The force also depends on the orientation of the object with respect to the oncoming airflow. This is called the angle of attack, denoted by the Greek letter alpha. Angles are presented using the dimensionless radians. Therefore, while a contributor, it does not have a primary dimension. Instead, this contribution must frequently be represented using a special function. Here we will do so using the function f of alpha. A common form of this function for lift and drag are shown at the end of this video. We also know that viscosity mu, represented by the primary dimensions m divided by the product L times T, contributes to the force. The more viscous a fluid, the larger the force. A basic representation of these contributions is shown, where r is a function of rho, v, L, alpha, and mu. Additionally, r is the dependent variable because its magnitude depends on the independent variables rho, v, L, alpha, and mu. Next, let's prepare the following table for further implementation of Buckingham's Pi theorem. For clarity, let's rewrite the function for r. Step 1. Let's set up parameters for r. This includes r as well as rho, v, L, alpha, and mu. note that the total number of parameters, n, equals 5. Ordinarily, it would be 6 here, but it is 5 since alpha is dimensionless. Step 2. Enter primary dimensions. These are mass, length, and time. Note that these constitute three primary dimensions denoted as r. Also note, it may be helpful to jot down actual dimensions for clarity. Step 3. The above steps show that the number of dimensionless pi groups that must be formed is n minus r, which equals 2. This means we have to create two pi groups. You will see this shortly. Note that the term dimensionless means the manipulation of primary dimensions must result in m to the power 0, l to the power 0, and t to the power 0. You will see this shortly as well. Step 4. Select parameters for the two pi groups. Pick the dependent variable r to lead the first group. To lead the second group, let's pick mu, as it is the most obscure parameter of the batch. Now let's prepare the two pi groups. The first pi group consists of the product r times rho to the power a times v to the power b times l to the power c times the dimensionless function of alpha that accounts for the orientation of the body in the fluid. Here it is simply included for completion. It does not contribute to the results because it is dimensionless. The Pi-theorem allows us to determine the values of the powers a, b, and c, and this is our main task. Recall that the force r is written in terms of the derived quantity m times l divided by t squared, as shown. Similarly, density rho is m by l cubed, speed v is l by t, and length l is simply capital L. Next, we write pi group 1 in terms of the base and derived quantities raised to the appropriate power as shown. Like I just said, we are going to determine the values of a, b, and c such they result in m, l, and t on the left-hand side of the equal sign, each having a power of 0. Next, rewrite this with the powers explicitly written as shown. Then rewrite this with the denominators written using minus signs. Then, recombine powers for m, l, and t. Now let's solve for the powers. In order for m to have a power of 0, requires that 0 is equal to a plus 1. For l to have a power of 0, requires that 0 is equal to b plus c minus 3a plus 1. And for t to have a power of 0, requires that 0 is equal to minus 2 minus b. The top condition is easily solved. 0 is equal to a plus 1, therefore a must equal minus 1. By inspection, we see that we must solve for a and b before we can determine c in the center condition. Thus, let's first solve the bottom equation for t. The condition for t requires that 0 is equal to minus b minus 2. Therefore, b must be equal to minus 2. Substituting the known values of a and b into the center condition results in c being equal to minus 2. Now we rewrite pi group 1 as shown here. Pi 1 was equal to r times rho to the power a times v to the power b times l to the power c times the dimensionless function of alpha. Substituting the values of a, b, and c leads to this, which we can also write as that. This, in effect, means that the aerodynamic force r is equal to rho times v squared times length squared times the dimensionless function of alpha. L squared implies area. You may see already that the function of alpha is a placeholder for something like a force coefficient, like lift coefficient or drag coefficient. It is also traditional to place one half in front of rho to emulate the expression for dynamic pressure. Of course, we can argue that the function f of alpha is thus twice as large as it would have to be if this wasn't done. Either way, the magnitude of the force is the same. Alrighty, now let's take care of the second pi group. It consists of the product mu times rho to the power d times v to the power e times l to the power f, where mu is written in terms of m divided by the product l times t, rho is m divided by l cubed, v is l divided by t, and l is capital L. Then we proceed as we did before, by manipulating the quantities and the power to which they are raised. Then solving for D, E, and F leads to the values shown. Similar to our earlier action, we rewrite pi group 2 as shown here. Pi 2 was equal to mu times rho to the power d times v to the power e times l to the power f. Substitute the values of d, e, and f leads to this, which can also be written as that. The inverse of this quantity is the expression for the well-known Reynolds number. Thus, in deriving the expression for the aerodynamic force, we have shown that it implicitly depends on the Reynolds number. This dependency is realized through surface friction, also called skin friction, whose magnitude depends, in part, on Reynolds number. We can now write the aerodynamic force R, as shown here, using the dimensionless coefficient C sub R. It is the function that depends on the orientation of the body and the fluid. We can also write similar expressions for the lift and drag, using the lift coefficient C sub L and drag coefficient C sub D. For those specifically, the dependency of the angle of attack alpha can be written as shown, at least in the linear region of the lift curve, and using the adjusted drag model.